I can show you the world, shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now when did you last let your heart decide? Tell us now.
Esta
a hundred thousand things
Yes, Esther.
Okay. Hello, you can hear me?
But you're very low.
Okay, just a minute. Is this any better now?
Hello?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but you're extremely very, very low.
Wow, this is amusing. My maximum volume.
So as we are sitting, we'll be looking at a girl, man.
That's not moving.
We'll be looking at the perspective.
That's not moving. So that's what I'm telling you.
Am I any louder now?
This is another webinar.
Hello, Esther.
Which you should make me
Hello?
Deliver to the young people. Eh? Even the mature.
Hello?
Hello?
I don't know the device you're using, but just, I think you're very far away from the microphone.
Okay.
Am I any louder now?
No, that is better.
Thank you.
All right. And then we can test the camera as well. You could try to bend your camera a little bit. Perfect.
Yes.
That's perfect. You're mute, so I can't hear you.
I'm secret. Ready.
Yeah. So we are going to start with some music in the background. I'll be playing some music.
Yes, please.
Then at exactly 5 minutes past one, I'll be stopping the music. So that will be a signal for you to start.
Okay.
I guess the rest of the flow of that thing was already shared by Sulaiman.
Yes, yes, please.
Yeah, I've already prepared the poll, both the pre and the post.
Okay.
All right.
Sorry, just for guidance, at what point does the post poll come in? I was only informed of the first.
The post, after when we join the Q&A, so before we answer the last question of the Q&A, that is when we run the post. Then the speaker will attempt the last questions of the Q&A. Then you give them the results of the post. I'll be sharing them as you present them to the audience. Then you wind up.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
welcome you on board for season two. For the season two, Banking and Financial Services Awareness Month. My name is Esther Nakafero, and I work with the Uganda Insurance Association under the Agro Consortium, which is the Secretariat of Agriculture Insurance. I'm going to give us an additional 2 minutes such that we can all settle, then we'll officially start this session.
Shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now when did you last let your heart decide? I can open your eyes, take you wonder by wonder, over, sideways, and under, on a magic carpet ride.
My name is Esther Nakafere once again, and we can officially start this session. This is a Banking and Financial Services Awareness Campaign, and we thank the Uganda Institute of Banking and Financial Services and Uganda Bankers Association in collaboration with Bank of Uganda for creating for us this space where we can pass on information. Through this series of free webinars, we'll talk about money, we are going to talk about personal financial management, savings, loans, insurance, investments, retirement, taxation, there'll be digital finance, and we'll have different experts that will take us through these sessions, basically from the time you make money, how are you getting investment, how are you making returns on this money, what savings plans do you have for the money, what are your retirement plans for some of us who are still young, and how are you in case of unforeseen cases, maybe health insurance, the life insurance, agriculture insurance. So it's basically personal financial management training. We focus on different audiences, women, youth, SMEs, and family, the youth, the older people of the society. We thank our sponsors for creating this platform: Uganda Insurers Association, Housing Finance Bank, Equity Bank, Finance Trust Bank, DFCU, Citibank, KCB, Financial Intelligence Authority, ABSA, Mercantile, Exim Bank, Finca Uganda, NCBA, Uga Ford Microfinance Limited, BRAC, Bank of Uganda, DTB, ABC Capital Bank, Bank of Baroda, Tropical Bank, and Uganda and Cairo Bank. Today, under the Banking and Financial Services Awareness Month webinar series, today this is our seventh webinar, and we're going to be talking about understanding of agriculture insurance in Uganda. Brief about agriculture insurance. As I mentioned earlier, that I work with Uganda Insurers Association under agriculture insurance, and I handle the claims department. Basically, I'm the person who says that insurance works and we pay for those who suffer losses. A brief about agriculture insurance. Agriculture insurance has been around for some time now, for a few years, but the time it started, the cost of insurance to a farmer were very high. You'd find that someone has to pay a lot of money to safeguard themselves against unforeseen circumstances that would arise in case of a crop or loss of an animal. Yesterday, I happened to attend the session by Fiona Magezi, who took us through insurance, backbone of insurance, what is insurance, some of the terms we're using, premium, the cost of insurance, what does it, when you suffer loss, what are the different plans that are there in insurance, how can you protect yourself in case of health insurance, in case of your life, in case of a business. Majority of us have a misconception that farming is more of a hobby, yet farming is actually a business. And with agriculture insurance, at the end of the presentation, you will learn that it does not matter whether you have one cow, whether you have one goat, whether you have half an acre of beans, or you have 500 acres of maize. To us, a farmer is a farmer, and the insurance is open to anyone who has, even if it's just a garden, a small garden of cabbages, everyone can come on board for this insurance. As I mentioned, that agriculture is a backbone of our economy, but it's one of the sectors that has suffered a lot. There are so many things that lead to loss, that create losses for farmers, yet we as farmers, we can't control this. Majority of these things are unfortunately weather-related risks. You find that even in your small bean plantation, a drought, you planted, seasons keep changing, that is a fact. You planted in maybe July and you thought it was going to rain till October, but unfortunately the rain has started in November. So what are you going to do? We are having on board so many small farmers, smallholder farmers. These are people who come in groups, and we realize that majority of these people are in circles, where you find that someone goes to a circle and are getting a loan over losing everything. They can't repay the loan. They have harvested nothing. So at the end of the day, a farmer is losing. But today we are here to bring you the good news of agriculture insurance. Agriculture insurance was the government of Uganda came up with a way of helping a farmer, you and I as farmers. How? The cost of insurance to a farmer has been subsidized. By subsidized, I mean it has been discounted. Through the presentations, you realize that we have different categories of farmers, and the government actually contributes part of the cost of insurance, such that we are able to realize more people on board, and insurance is not expensive to a farmer. It's against this background that the Uganda National health insurance scheme was formed. This is a private-public partnership between government of Uganda and the farmers, and it's been implemented through Uganda Insurers Association. I work with the Agro Consortium, which is the union of the 13 insurance companies that are currently participating in this. It's through the Uganda National Agriculture Scheme that government is able to channel the money that's then discounts the cost of insurance to the farmers. Under the Agro Consortium at the moment, there are 13 member organization insurance companies. We have National Insurance Company, we have Alliance Africa, we have GA, we have APA, we have Parks Insurance, we have UAP, we have MUA, we have First Insurance Company, we have CIC Insurance, we have Excel Insurance. It's at this point that I'm going to introduce to you our guest speaker. Our panelist today is going to at the Agro Consortium, Uganda Insurers Association. Mr. Munyaradzi Daka has 29 years of experience in the insurance sector, including life and business. He has expertise in agriculture insurance, working towards financial inclusion and risk management of vulnerable sectors of the society. Mr. Munyaradzi Daka has a business and IT background and extensive private sector experience. He's currently based at Uganda Insurers Association on the agriculture desk and is a technical lead for initiatives related to disaster risk, climate risk, and agriculture insurance distribution, building scale efficiency through use of technology in Uganda, and is also a technical member of the Uganda National Agriculture Insurance Scheme. To guide us through the discussion, we are going to have a poll in a few minutes. You'll see a sort of questionnaire that will be appearing on our screens. This is going to guide us to know what kind of audience do we have today, what kind of profession backgrounds are we dealing with, what kind of age brackets are we looking at, and it will help us guide our discussion. So within a few seconds from now, it could be displayed on our screens. I believe that this has been displayed to all of us, so kindly answer in around 1 or 2 minutes such that we can proceed. There is a good question here. Are you in the agriculture business? As I've mentioned, even if you have just one cow or 30 hens, please tick yes, because you're actually dealing in agriculture business. Personally, I'm done with my submission, and I hope you're all almost concluding with it. For those who are just joining us, thank you for creating time. I mean, it's the busy schedule you all have for joining us in this informative webinar. We are today, we are going to talk about agriculture insurance. And as I've mentioned, agriculture insurance forms backbone of our economy. So at any one point, I'm certain we all have an agriculture background, whether it's us directly or our parents for the youth, or at any one point, you can't run away from agriculture. I guess we are winding up with a poll for those who have just joined us. There's a poll on when kindly submit. Thank you all for your participation. As per today's webinar, we've realized that majority of the attendees at the moment fall within the age bracket of 31 to 50 years. Then the rest fall between 15 to 30 years. We don't have any between the age range of 51 to 60. Then we have 5% of these attendees so far who are between the age bracket of 61 to 80. Fortunately, 89% of us have confirmed that we are actually in agriculture business. We have majority of us as subsistence farmers. We have 26% as commercial farmers, while others have not been able to rate whether they fall between the commercial part or subsistence, whereby you're basically growing crops for home consumption. Majority of our participants today have been in practicing agriculture insurance for less than a year. 37% have been practicing agriculture insurance between 1 to 5 years. The rest have been practicing agriculture insurance for roughly 5 to 10 years. And we have 5% who have been in agriculture for more than 10 years. Fortunately, 74% have confirmed that you have heard about agriculture insurance, so we hope to have an interactive today. 58% have confirmed that you've heard about agriculture insurance before. This is not the first time that you are hearing someone discuss this. Well, 42%, this is your first time to hear about agriculture insurance. Then for those who had heard about our survey, it has come that 37% have heard about agriculture insurance and the sessions organized by the employers, while 26% the sessions organized through insurance organizations such as Uganda Insurance Association and IRA. 16% have heard about this through friends, 11% have heard about this through family, 11% have also heard about this through social clubs, and no one at the moment has obtained information through the savings group. With these statistics, allow me to invite our panelists.
Good afternoon. I hope you are all hearing me loud and clear. My name is Munya. My name is Munya. I hope you are all hearing me loud and clear. Great moderator did a very brilliant job to introduce the subject, and she also did some good flattery on my introduction. So I'll not just introduce myself and spoil whatever she had said in terms of when she was introducing. So I'll go right into the subject matter for today, which is understanding agriculture insurance and how we are doing it in Uganda. Different forms of looking at agriculture have been done in the various territories and countries. So we shall talk about what we are doing in Uganda, how we are doing it, how you can be able to access it, and then maybe we'll have a question and answer session for maybe whatever has not been clear or where you need more elaboration as we go on. So as my colleague Esther highlighted before, the advent of insurance only started recently in Uganda, of agriculture insurance, as recent as around 2010, 2013 is when people started to try and see what they could do in this sector in terms of agriculture insurance. There were various challenges that that came about, and which made it not be rolled out or scaled out or be made available at that point. The challenges that were there were, first of all, it takes a lot to do research and development on different products that needs to be rolled out to the insuring public. There's a lot of data and search that needs to come in. There's also a lot of feedback that you need to get from the eventual beneficiaries so that the product that you are doing makes sense for everyone, including the insurance company and the eventual beneficiary which the product is being done for, so that it's a relevant product and makes sense for everyone involved. So agriculture data for the purposes of agriculture insurance was not really adequate for us to be able to model different rating structures or models that we could use to make sure that the product is sustainable and also makes sense and also is sustainable. The agriculture is affected by a lot of weather conditions and issues. And for you to understand what happens and also to know and verify that these weather conditions or these weather issues actually happened or monitor them, you need to have a lot of infrastructure around the different regions or districts or parishes in the country, so you can collect and monitor the seasons as they go about. So this infrastructure at that point was not adequate for the products that we would want to do. So for example, you would need maybe in a sub-county, you might need various weather stations. Maybe you need at least a minimum of 3 or 4 or 10 strategically placed to collect as much information as possible. And this infrastructure at that point was not available. Distribution for the products is an essential part of any insurance product, especially for the micro insurance kind of products like agriculture is, because we normally serve a lot of the smallholder farmer. So these also had to be built up or put up so that they could support the products. And at the same time, the relevant ministries were also trying to put in place extension services to also make sure that these are supporting the farmers. And the same extension services is what also help us to get the relevant data especially production history in the different districts that we use to come up with our products, and also to know what level of values the farmers have basing on that. So all this was also a few, and we needed to get that developed so that we could ride on that and be able to do much more with that information. The major other problem was that most insurance companies were very averse in a way, or they were very worried about the risks that agriculture present, because the sector is prone to very systemic risks, meaning one risk can cover a whole big area. One, unlike when you look at motor vehicle, what happens with me driving in Barara is not the same effect. It doesn't have the same effect with someone who's in Kampala or somewhere else. But a weather event can actually be across the country. So this presents a very difficult proposition to the insurance companies. So at that point also, that made it quite difficult for insurance to see how they could diversify so that they could balance their portfolios and make sure that they can cushion losses. With this in mind, we, as of 2016-17, a lot of work was done to see how we could be able to overcome some of these issues. And with the advent of a lot of technology, a lot of these things started to be available, so data could be collected and some structures had been formed in terms of distribution avenues and all those things. And but still, what remained was that, like Esther put it in her opening remarks, the cost for insurance was still very high because of the obvious risks that agriculture presents to the insurance companies. I think from I believe from yesterday's presentations, we learned about how agriculture will use large numbers to make sure that the costs are low, and also how a risk, the more it's riskier, presents more exposure to the insurance companies, so they will have to rate it highly, meaning they will have to charge more. But with that, it didn't make the sector despair. We started looking around and saying, okay, what lessons can we learn across the world? And we started finding out one thing, that without a government support, most of these agriculture insurance products would not make it from inception or from their birth. They needed support, and then after some time they would then be able to survive on their own. And most of the other issues that we found out, that in the other territories, what they'd done was to the government to support the sector with different aspects. And one aspect that we picked, because which was our main challenge, was the initial cost to the farmer. So with that, we approached the government, and that's how the Uganda Agriculture Insurance Scheme was born. It was born to support in terms of data. We could be able to take advantage of the different arms of government and agencies of government who then would be able to be collecting in their normal day-to-day jobs that they do, collect for us data. So for example, the Minister of Agriculture with their extension workers, or the production officers in the different districts, would be able to make sure that we get data that we need for rating and coming up with our products. Then the government also committed to supporting the scheme with a subsidy, which I think she talked about, and which I'll also talk about a bit more in detail of how it works. And the premium and the subsidy was for premiums, not for claims, but really to help with paying premiums at, when you are taking out your policy at inception or at the beginning of a season. Also, smallholder and large-scale farmers access could be able to access insurance directly through the insurers or indirectly against, I mean, with the other broking in the broking fraternity, which is part of the infrastructure of the insurance sector. Then they would also come through the different aggregators that that are available, and then mainly with our especially our partners in this financial week, the bankers and or the banking fraternity, where they would be able to, as they unlock credit for the farmers, that also is supported by agriculture insurance. Government also committed to support education, farmer education, using the scheme. At the same time, the sector itself also embarked in doing a lot of farmer education on how agriculture insurance actually helps. And I guess also this is part of some of this education on seeing how you can take advantage of this risk transfer mechanism to be able to protect or mitigate against financial losses. The scheme's objective, the scheme, which is the Uganda Agriculture Insurance Scheme, was to first reduce food insecurity, to stabilize and eventually increase household incomes. And then on another hand, especially for the large-scale farmers, to increase export earnings for the country. This was to do this by making sure once you you are aware that your income, I mean your investment financially is protected, you can invest more. By investing more, it means you are making sure that you have that food security. And then if you invest more again, obviously you have an increase in your income. And then for the larger scale, medium to larger scale farmers, the more you invest, the more you actually earn more exports earnings for the country. And this you are doing because you know that you've got a fallback position. Should anything happen in terms of the risks that you can't control, like drought and excessive rainfall or pests and diseases, then at least your financial part is protected. As a note, we also made sure that we also try and make sure that the scheme encourages participation of women farmers because they are increasingly becoming the breadwinners through their farming activities. So these were the overall objectives of the scheme and are still the objectives of the scheme. The scheme is implemented across the country. It's not based per region, it's across the country. So in the five regions, broad regions, Western, Eastern, Central, West Nile, and the North, wherever you are, as long as you are a farmer, you take part and you can take part in the scheme. Participation is limited to those crops that were picked by the National Committee to be those that are strategic and also ensure a fair distribution of the subsidy across the country. These is listed below from coffee, tea, maize, rice, cassava, beans, bananas, and we also insure fish separately. Then livestock, which is comes with the meat. So we do the beef, and then we also do dairy, cattle, and then fruits, horticulture, which encompasses vegetables. We have since gone on to add more crops from the beginning of this fiscal year. We've added sugarcane, trees, we've added bees, sheep, goats, as part of what we also cover. Then we also have strategic commodities, cotton, oil, oilseeds, and cocoa as part of those that are under the scheme. And then for livestock, I think I've already highlighted cattle, whether beef or dairy, piggery, poultry, and then aquaculture, which is fish. The scheme started by, as we know that farmers have got different risks that they face. They will face from production risks, marketing risks, post-handling issues, post-harvest handling issues. That whole value chain, they've got different challenges that they have. But at the start of the scheme, it was seen that the rest of, especially the general insurance sector was already covering some of these, especially the post-harvest issues like transit to the markets, when anything happens during transit to the markets, deterioration of stocks, fires when they happen in a storage place and all those things. We're already been covered by the general insurance sector, but what was not being taken up was the production risks. So the scheme took up these production risks. And for crops, we look at natural disasters like droughts and excessive rainfalls, floods, storms, hail, as part of what we cover. So basically some of those weather related issues, including frost, especially for things like tomatoes, things like if you do things like wheat, we'll then look at that. We also look at pests and diseases. And then we also look at damage from wild animals. I put production risks as wheat competition is part of a production risk, but it's really not what insurance covers. It is a risk, yes, but it's a risk which the farmer should be able to deal with when they do their farm practices well. In terms of livestock, again, we look at the weather effects on the pastures and on the livestock itself. For example, if there's drought and then there's a lack of pasture, then you can lose your animals, especially those that freely graze or graze in ranches. Then you can have issues. Sometimes you might fail to even supplement the feed because maybe where you need to get it also is affected. So we will look at that. We also look at disease, and this is quite common in livestock, especially with poultry, piggery. We've got quite a lot of incidences of diseases. And sometimes you can have predators that can kill or injure the animals to the extent that you can lose the animals. So the production risk is what the scheme is looking at. But as we are growing, we are also now looking at if we could look at any other supporting risks that we could start to develop products for, so that if we can be a one-stop shop for the farmer in terms of what they need for their financial mitigation of losses that they encounter in their farming practices and activities. We have four broad products that we use to cover these risks that I've been talking about. And the most common, which is most common throughout the world, which has been used traditionally by insurance companies, is called the multi-peril crop insurance, which in short, we normally call it MPCI. Mulch peril, meaning it covers many of the risks that the farmer faces. All those other risks that I've talked about, from pest diseases, drought, flood, a fire, especially like sugar can be damaged by fire, and this is very prevalent. So mulch peril tries to cover all those perils that the farmer faces. Now with mulch peril, we have to be at the ground to actually inspect a farmer's field to actually see what risk it presents to us. And when you go to the field, you then also give a report to the farmer on if they are farming well. And if we think they are not farming well, we would advise. And at this point, we can be able to decline or take on the risk. Sometimes we might take it on with conditions of saying, please look at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 things so that you can improve and make your farming venture more successful. So not only are we providing just the compensation for in terms of losses, but we're also providing kind of advisory services, almost extension services as we come to the farm. If we follow up after we've inspected the farm and we've got follow-up issues that we need to attend to during the season, we then send back the inspector again to see if those were done. And then finally, before the farmer harvests, we've got what we call pre-harvest inspection, where the inspector again goes and just checks on what has happened. Then if there is any loss, at that point, we will now send an adjuster, who, just like in the other forms of insurance, goes to verify whether there was indeed a loss, and if it was there, what was the extent of that loss, and then they will give us a report in which we will now best to do our compensation. So you can see that if we take the same model, and now we have a farmer saying deep in Koboko, or even not even far, maybe here in say Iganga or any of those areas around, and is doing only 0.5 acres of maize. His value is really around maybe 300,000 shillings. If we are to charge him maybe 5%, it means we are looking at about 15,000 shillings is the premium that we are going to charge that farmer. Now, if we are to send someone, at most, the inspector maybe at the least twice, it means just the cost of sending them for transport takes away all the premium that would have charged. This is before we've even put into account their professional fees. So what it means is that this form of product is not suitable for the small holder. But we didn't want them to left behind. So the good thing is that as things were growing, we started having technology improvements, and we started seeing that we could now use technology to be able to replace some of the issues or some of the services that the inspector was supposed to do for us, or on terms of adjustment, what the adjuster or assessor would do for us for the small scale farmer. So with the advent of being able to use satellite technology, we were able now to start offering satellite based insurance to the various farmers. This kind of insurance, where you are using the technology and is measuring mostly what causes a loss to infer what the loss would be on the ground. So for example, you look at measuring rainfall, and you say, okay, if the rainfall is not adequate, what is the correlation to what yield should have been at the farm? So if you're saying if it's the rainfall received was 50%, maybe at the farm, the resultant loss is about 80%. So we have done models to look at how the effects of the different conditions like temperature, rainfall, access to water, for availability of water to the plant, and different things like that affect the yield itself. And then we just measure the lack of those things to infer what the loss would be. So in that way, we don't need to send someone to that farm because we can just use that information. So this is what we use for the small scale farmer. Another product we have is livestock mortality. Mortality meaning that it only kicks in when that particular animal has actually died from what we are insuring. So for example, if the livestock was hit by a car and it dies, then yes, it's covered, or it suffered a disease, or maybe it's poultry, they've caught on Newcastle disease and then they die from that disease, then it's that's how the policy will now compensate and kick in. So it is a mortality product. I'll also put a bit of qualification here, because there are times when you find that an animal has broken its leg, and the vet will now say, due to this injury, it will not recover well and eventually it will die. So the vet will now say, okay, you can go ahead and actually slaughter this animal or kill this animal because it's going to suffer more and it's not going to recover. What they call mercy killing. The insurance will then kick in and as if the animal actually died, although you are slaughtering it from instruction from the vet. The fourth products that we cover, which we have not been extensively marketing currently, is the NDVI, which means non-differential vegetative index, which in just in plain just means you are looking at the greenness of areas. This is used in the livestock side to just look at pasture. The greener the vegetative index looks, it means there's adequate pasture. And the way it, when it goes more black and red, then you know that there's no pasture and animals are going to suffer. So again, you infer between those extremes on what the resultant is on the ground, and then be able to watch to see what percentage of loss it is that you pay out to the farmer. In some cases, you just pay for additional, maybe for them to look for additional pasture or supplement the pasture. That's what you will do. Or for their relocation to an area where there is better pasture. So the cost of them doing that then is part of what is compensated by the insurance. We talked about subsidy. So each year, the government avails to us 5 billion towards helping paying the premiums for the farmers. So this has meant it a bit lighter for the farmers, because to reduce the outlay that they have in terms of insurance premium. And this subsidy is directed towards just the that's the premiums. So in my case that that I highlighted before, the case of a farmer in Iganga who was doing 0.5 acres and is supposed to pay 15,000 in terms of his premium, the government now then come in and subsidize on that 15,000. How it's done is done based on what you are according to the scheme, whether you are a small scale farmer or you are a large scale farmer. And in the definition of the scheme, anyone who's doing less than 5 acres of cultivated land is a small scale farmer, or if you are doing less than 20 million shillings of seasonal income. If you are defined as a small scale farmer in the scheme, then you get paid, you get access to 50% subsidy from the government. So in the case that I have given as an example, if you are supposed to pay 15,000, all you need to do now is you need to pay 7.5, which is 50%. Once you pay your 7.5, it's assumed you are totally covered, because the other 7.5 is going to come from this government subsidy. On the other hand, if you're a large scale farmer, meaning you are doing more than 5 acres or more than 20 million shillings seasonal income, you only get 30% of government subsidy, and then you contribute 70%. When it comes to livestock, we looked at numbers. So you see from this presentation that anyone doing less than 2,000 poultry is deemed a small scale farmer, and then you get 50% subsidy, and so on and so forth, depending on which line of livestock you are doing. For those in aquaculture, which is those that are farming fish, whether you are doing it offshore or onshore, you only get, there's no small definition of, that differentiation of small scale or large scale. Everyone there will have to pay 70%, and the government will contribute 30%. Then we also saw that there are areas that are continually prone with these disasters. So they are disaster prone in our definition of we have districts that we have seen that are disaster prone, and in these districts whether you're a small scale or large scale farmer contributes 80% subsidy, and then you as the farmer, you only contribute 20%. Now, I've talked briefly on how I've using the Iganga farmer as an example on how the values or how you ensure that maize or whatever beans that you are doing. So how you value your crops for insurance, we have basically three ways that we insure based on. One is yield. So you will look at what yield you are going to expect, which is what I use for the Iganga farmer. And how to calculate that is it's a simple calculation. Well, the first thing that we look at is that what average yield have you been getting over the years for that season? What was the season average? If you have been getting 1,000 kilograms of maize per acre for that season, that's what we will take. And then we'll then multiply that by the area that you are planting. Are you planting 1 acre, 0.5, or you're planting 5 acres, whatever it is that you're planting, we'll multiply with that. Then what is your expectation of sales at the end of the season? The market, what is the market price that is expected in that area? So if it's 1,000, then per kg for maize, or if it's 600 or 500 for maize, then that's what you then also multiply that with. For large-scale farmers who are using the multi-peril crop insurance product, which is the MPCI, we only guarantee 75%. We don't guarantee 100% for that, because we feel the other 25% are other factors that the farmer themselves might still have suffered, whether the loss of drought or anything might have come in or not. because this could be quality of seed, this could be farming practice, this could be fertilizers that were not up to standard or anything of that sort. But for the small scale farmer, this guarantee is not there, because the product we use, like I said, it's a proxy product. We look at what are the causes of the loss, and then we already factored those things of quality seeds and all those things into the yield prediction that we have, and then so we don't have that guarantee in that product, which is the weather index. We also do input costs, which means the cost that you used for fertilizer, seed, and all those. You can just insure those input costs only. And the third one would be to insure your loan. We use that a lot with the financial institutions. I just wanted to give also a brief so that people see that really it's not an expensive they are not expensive products anymore, because of firstly the help from the government, and also secondly because it's a well now a countrywide scheme. The rates all reduced to some, to around 5% average. So this 5% is before the government comes in with these subsidies. So in some areas, the farmer ends up paying even 1% because of the 80% subsidy, or 2.5% because of the 50% subsidy. So this just gives an insight into the level of charges that we have for in the agricultural insurance sector. For livestock, it's straightforward how to value. You can value the animal as the value of what its value will be at the end of the insurance period. So because for livestock, we cover it annually. So you can, if you take it today, at the end of November, we need to know what value you would put for that animal. And that value will just multiply by the number of animals that you have. That shows what sub-insured or what value of insurance that you have at the farm. The other one is also the best on acquiring the cost of acquiring the animal, especially for those that are doing fattening and such ventures. And the third one is insuring for the loan that you would have taken to venture into this farming activity. The scheme has seen quite a lot of successes since we began in 2016. I will give you a bit of numbers after this slide, but we have seen that it's now a very functional private public partnership, where each person is doing their role, and we are seeing it impacting on the end beneficiary, which is the farmer. It has also seen a lot of collaboration within the insurance sector, and I must say also even with the other financial services sectors. So the banking industry has been working with us also a lot in making sure that we are coming with these products that actually help the mitigate the pain that the farmers would have when these calamities happen. And what it has done is that we've been able to be doing a lot of local solutions to our local problems, not waiting for someone to come in and show us what to do. Yet we are in the ground with the people and know exactly what their issues are. And some such forums as we have today also help, because then we get feedback of any other issues that are there with either the scheme or any other things that we have not looked at, to see how do we improve this and go forward. Just to give numbers as at end of last year, 2020, we had we have 259,000 farmers, 260 roughly, insured, with a sum insured of over 1 trillion and premiums in the region of about 9 billion. And I always say that we always also need to show that we are compensating. So we need to always show what we are compensating. And we've compensated up to 10 billion, that is up to 2020. This last season has not been a particularly good season. So I think this figure of 10 billion was just in one season for last season, and it can be even more than that. So you can see that we are not just being there and saying there's agriculture insurance, but claims are actually coming in and are actually being paid. I think I'll stop here, if that is fine. If there are any questions, I will gladly take those.
Thank you so much for that presentation, Mia. We have a few questions so far. Some are also reflecting on your side as well. Thank you for being elaborative in a very short period of time. You've talked about the genesis of agriculture insurance, the products offered, what kind of farmers can come on board. We're going to go through some of the questions. I forgot to mention, in case of any question, kindly put it in the chat room, and we'll be able to address it. The first question has been raised by Mr. Oboa Emmanuel to you, Mr. Munya, that how is this rolled out to small-scale holder farmers in rural areas? When you look at the gaps from introduction, how has the infrastructure improved so far? And information sharing beyond this point, how is this related to smallholder farmers? Because there's still gaps in digital connection, as you could be aware that the majority of these people don't even have phones. That's one of the questions. I would take three questions that are good, and Munya can respond for an interactive space. That's the first question. Another question by Mr. Ibra, kindly elaborate more on NDVI, what is it? The same question was also raised by Pius. What farmer categories does the NDVI product support? And still asking for elaborative information on NDVI. Then a submission from Albert about the presentations to be shared, as people are not taking notes at the moment. This will liaise with our organizers, and we see how to reach you, since I'm certain that for registration, we submitted our email addresses, so we'll be able to share the information. Mr. Munya, please take your questions.
Okay, thank you very much. I think the one of presentations you have already answered, because for us, we are going to forward the presentation to the relevant organizers for them to disseminate or pass around. In terms of how this is rolled out to the smallholder farmers in the rural area, so we've got different models and avenues that distribution channels that we are using. So there are different aggregators that are working with the farmers in the rural areas who now aggregate these farmers, and actually we train them to then explain the product to the rural farmer. So we use these aggregators as a way to roll out to the end of the smallholder farmer. At the same time, like I said, we work with the different government agencies. For example, right now we have an agreement in the in the memorandum of understanding where MAIF would then avail its extension services, workers or officers to be able to also, as part of the extension, bring out these products and explain them to the rural people. Then, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of I think improved sharing information of infrastructure and the gaps in digital connection. This is correct. The assumption had been that a lot of farmers have got phones, and the reality is that most of them don't have phones. So, like I said, we will use aggregation between their own organizations, their own, whether it's village level or parish level organization, and then we now aggregate through that. When it comes to payment, we'll make sure that again there's the same way that we collected the money is the same way that it gets back to the to the individual beneficiary. We do encourage them to be having, for example, just a normal simple phone, so that we can be able to pass their money through through the telecom, different telecoms money transfer services. So that's another way that that we reach out and are able to close that that gap. Also, we've been going out now into the region and placing our own people in the region, who are also going to start also having people in the different critical or what we feel where most of the services are needed, so that they can be a point of contact to the farmer and be able to go to provide these services or respond to any queries or handle any challenges that the farmers are facing with the product. I think the other question of two people talked on NDVI. Like I said, NDVI is another form of index cover. So index, like I explained, is a way of ensuring that without actually physically going to inspect something. So you look at what causes the loss. So the example I gave maybe would be rainfall. So you say if rainfall causes a loss in yield, how much of that lack of rainfall causes what kind of loss in yield. So you now just measure the rainfall and know that if it's this much lack of rainfall, so much is going to be lost in yield. Now it's the same concept that we use for NDVI, which means non-differential vegetative index. It's a very long complex kind of description of the product, but what it just means, I like to translate it to be the greenness of an area. So if a pasture, the more it is green, the more you expect that there is rain. If it's going brown, then you know that there is lack of rain. So the satellite now in its images tries to look at that greenness by taking images of the area that you are insuring to see what level of that greenness is there. And then you would have in the background calculated that the shades or the different shades of that greenness represent a certain lack of water for the pastures. So NDVI is normally used for, especially the nomadic pastoralists. That's what it. They use quite a lot of. We use quite a lot of NDVI for such people because they are the ones that have to go and look for where pastures. So when their pasture is affected, they have to go somewhere else to look for pasture. So the product helps them with costs for such. Or sometimes if you lack pasture, you actually have the animal will die because of lack of pasture. So we pay for that animal. I think that will be on NDVI. Then I've just seen another question here. Please re-clarify on eligibility criteria. Anyone who is farming in Uganda, as long as you are farming in Uganda and you are farming the crops that we have we have highlighted, and we tried to be extensive with the list of the crops and the livestock or the and also fish. So as long as you are farming in Uganda, you are eligible to be able to get to access the cover. And what happens if loss is due to poor care? We do not ensure whether it's poor care or poor farming practices, because we feel and we know that, we assume that when you are farming, at least you are going to be doing the proper farming practices. That's why we also give you extension services or advice or advisory services at the beginning, especially for MBCI. We also started to do it for the small scale farmers, where we send our own risk officers that we recently deployed. They'll go to the area and actually help the small scale farmers on what is the best practices of farming. So we do not cover your losses that come from poor farming practices or poor care of animals. And it's very easy to determine this because, for example, on livestock, we use vets who are able to know the history of the animal and what is causing its problems, whether it's just poor care or its disease. So they are able to give us a report on that. Same with the agronomists can be able to give us on the health of the crop. The crop, is it because there's no nutrients in the crop? Is it because you failed to weed and there was weed competition? They can be able to do this very simply and very easily. So I think I've covered most of the questions that were there.
Thank you, Munya. We'll take on two more questions. Barbara asked that of the statistics shared, how many were smallholder farmers? And you've answered this, how we are marketing agriculture insurance to the smallholder farmers. Then Albert has asked that what insurance companies are on ground in Eastern Uganda, specifically Kabera Maido District, to provide agriculture insurance.
Okay, there is no specific insurance company that I know that is in that district currently, but services from any one of our members, we've got 13 members that are form part of the consortium. So any of the 13 members, anyone who's near that area can service that area. But at the same time also, us as the consortium, we when there is a need and anyone reaches out to us, we can actually go to that area and be able to bring the services to those people. And at that point, we can always establish with the client or the farmer who is the best, they will tell us who they would want to insure with. And then that's how, among our members, that's how we will then proceed. So that is about the offices. Maybe I've missed the first question was?
Of the statistics shared, showing the number of farmers insured, how many were smallholder farmers?
Okay. Actually, the majority of our farmers insured, of the numbers that I showed, are actually smallholders. So we've got about 96% of farmers being smallholder farmers. in terms of even in terms of our premium income, there is really coming from a lot of these smallholder farmers. Though you have quite big commercial farms that come in and bring quite a lot of premium, but in terms of numbers, 96% is smallholder farmers.
Before we take on the last question from Ibrahim, we are going to have another poll, a post-training survey. This will help us gauge ourselves, rate ourselves. Have we actually understood what Mr. Munya has been trying to take us through for over an hour? We are also going to share our contact information in the chat such that the discussion is open. Incidentally, we have a toll-free number, so you can always call between 8 to 5 p.m. and someone will always be able to take one the questions. The post-training survey will appear on our screen shortly, but the last question we'll take on for today to you, Mr. Daka. What is multi-peril insurance again, and is it favorable to small-scale farmers as well?
Okay. I've also seen one on the chat. Maybe I'll also take that one also that is on the chat. But multi-peril, again, means just it's a policy that is taking on many, many perils. Many perils mean many risks. So, for example, you have your floods, your fire, your drought, your excessive rainfall, your pests and diseases, and all. So that is what multi-peril covers. This obviously is the most comprehensive of the products, but it has got it has got its limitation when you come to the small scale farmer, as I explained, in terms of costs. So when the small scale farmer, for the small scale farmer, currently we are able to provide them with the drought and excessive rainfall cover currently using the weather index. And I think the last question that I saw here was, is agricultural insurance offered yet as part of bank assurance portfolio? Definitely, yes. Most of the banks are offering agricultural insurance in their bank assurance platforms.
Thank you so much, Munya. We'll also at this moment have your winding remarks in a minute or so before we can proceed.
I didn't get
the winding remarks before we can proceed.
Okay, oh, thank you. As a passing shot, I would like to thank those that were on the platform and the organizers and our umbrella body, the Insurance Association and the Bankers Institute, Institute of Bankers, for the opportunity for us to come out and talk to the various people that attended. Agriculture insurance is a growing sector, and it's a critical sector that we need to be able to take advantage of, especially now that we have got quite a lot of support from the various government arms and institutes, and also the private sector is doing quite a lot to do it. So it is time to be able to take advantage of this. It's been proven from the amount of claims that we are paying that it does work. And then we've got quite a lot of testimonials. It's not taking it just from us, but quite a lot of testimonials in those that have gotten the products and be able to work with the products, so they will be able to also give you comfort that this actually works. So again, thank you for the opportunity, and hopefully we'll see some of you coming in to use the products and being able to be helped by the products that we are offering. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Munya. We are yet to conduct the post-training survey, but we have around 5 minutes to conclude this session. I thank everyone who has taken time off their busy schedules today to join us for this training. The poll has appeared on our screens. Let's take a minute to fill it in. Can you take a minute to fill in this poll? Thank you all for joining us today. I've put our contact details and our location in the chat so everyone can access it. We are seated at Uganda Insurance Association, which is John Babiha Akesha Avenue. We thank our stakeholders. We thank Uganda Insurance Association. We thank Capital Markets Authority, CFA East Africa, Uganda Retirement Benefits Regulatory Authority, Uganda Microfinance Regulatory Authority for collaborating such that we can be able to deliver this awareness. We also thank the sponsors, Housing Finance, Equity Finance Trust Bank, DFCU, Citibank, KCB, Financial Intelligence Authority, ABSA, Mercantile, Exim Bank, Uganda, Finca, NCBA. UGA Food Microfinance, BRAC Bank Uganda, Bank of Africa Uganda, DTB, ABC Capital Bank, Bank of Baroda, Tropical Bank, and Cairo. And we are going to have another series today at 6 p.m. The topic will be centered around retirement investing, how to build your confidence. It will be, the session will be moderated by Mrs. Miriam Sally, who is the Director of Legal Services, Capital Markets Authority. So kindly join us as well for that. Thank you so much for your participation. Please reach out to us as per the details we shared. My take home would be that, as Mr. Munya has explained, that there's money. I mean, government is putting money, 5 billion every year. So aside all of us knowing that agriculture is a very risky business, and at least we've seen that whatever you expect as at the beginning of the season, it doesn't turn out that way because you don't have control over most of the things that lead you to face losses. As a result, I hope that we can continue this chat. I hope that we can join agriculture insurance or at least inform others, because majority of our age bracket was 31 to 50 years. I believe we are all farmers, we just don't know it yet. So kindly join us, kindly make use of the money that we're getting from the government. The results of the survey have rated you, Mr. Munyadaka, very good at 70%. So thank you so much for taking us through the training. And good was 30%. Fortunately, no one has rated you as a very poor or average panelist. So thank you so much. We've noticed that 45% have said the information was new to us, and that almost everyone says that the session, they can use this information as soon as now. Mr. Munya, you've been rated by Majuchi as a very excellent speaker, and few people rated you as a very good speaker. And we've seen that 100% of the people want to attend more of the banking and financial services training. At this note, allow me in the discussion, but we are still open on our phone number or our email address in case someone wants to engage us in person. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, organizers, for this, for giving us this platform, because part of our mandate is to actually make sure that everyone is aware of the agriculture insurance existence in Uganda. Thank you so much. I remain Esther Nakafero. I work as a claims handler at Agro Consortium, Uganda Insurance Association.
show you the world, shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now when did you last let your heart decide? I can open your eyes, take you wonder by wonder, over sideways and under. On a magic carpet ride, a whole new world, a new fantastic point of view. No one to tell us no, or where to go, or say we're only dreaming. Let me share this heart.